I'm not an expert game developer. I don't know different engines, I don't have years of experience, but I kind of want to take this up a notch. I'm all about learning here on this channel, and I think it's beneficial for a builder to know their tools. And what are the tools for a game developer? Game engines. I always knew that I would eventually try out different tools at my disposal purely because I want to be able to make educated decisions for my games. Recently, the folks at GameMaker reached out to me for a video, and since this was already an idea I had in my head to try more tools, I said, let's learn GameMaker. I did have a catch. I want this to be my honest first reaction alongside me learning the software for the first time. So I wanted to be able to share my opinion no matter what that opinion is. Did they agree? Well, you tell me. Thanks to GameMaker for sponsoring this video. Use the link in the description to download it and start making games today. Oh yeah, there's another catch. Doing the math on when this video is getting published, giving myself enough time for editing, I have exactly 5 days to make a game in a new engine. Remember how my first game took me a year? Let's get started. I went to GameMaker.io and downloaded the engine. Once it was installed, I opened it for the very first time. At this point, I probably should have looked at some tutorials or something to familiarize myself, but I didn't. I don't know what to tell you. I think the creators of GameMaker are used to people like me though, because after clicking new, I see these project types, which look like templates to get people started. Even someone like me. After looking at a couple of them, I decided to try the one called Space Rocks for a very specific reason. Let's talk about the type of game I plan to make. The last game that I made, which is also the first game that I ever made, was an arcade-type shooter where you're trying to survive as long as you can against hordes of shapes and letters? Well, just X's, but anyway. I thought it might be a fun idea to take that idea and flip it on its head. So instead of controlling the ship to avoid the enemies, for this new game, you are the enemies, and the goal is to attack the ship. The Space Rocks template looked to be close enough in genre to the game I already wanted to make. I figured this would allow me to mess around with it and get a feel for the engine before moving on to my own project. Plus, I can get it working in just 15 minutes? Perfect. Let's open this up and... wait, where is it? I spent the first minute looking around the workspace when I found an interesting file in the asset browser. When I went to the link in the document, it led me to a very detailed explanation on how to make the Space Rocks game, with screenshots and everything. This was really amazing and super helpful. When I first clicked on this template file, I thought it was going to be a game that was mostly already made, but this is even better. I started by choosing my coding preference, either GML Code or GML Visual. I set my preference as GML Code, but I really like the fact that there's a visual coding option too. I went through a good portion of the tutorial, which went over movement, collision, and even adding little particle effects when you lose. I thought this was such a cool way to empower new users like me to be able to use the engine by equipping them with the sprites and explanations they need to learn the essentials. Although the 15-minute estimate might have been a little generous, or maybe I'm just slow. That's a very real possibility. Finally, I got to a point where I felt comfortable enough to start work on my own project. I imported some sprites, created some objects, and started setting up my very first room, which I named Level. From what I can tell, rooms seem to be similar to scenes in Godot, where you can add different game objects into them. I also made a game object, which will be controlling different aspects of the game, such as the coin spawning. I want these spawns to be random, and I had an issue in the asteroid game where the spawns didn't seem random, even though I was using the random function. And after a bit of searching, I found out that the randomize function is what I need to randomize the seed when the game starts. Also, can we just appreciate the fact that no matter which way you spell the word randomize, there's a function for you? So I was able to get the coin spawning pretty quickly, which is funny because I think this took me literal days when I was making my first game. Don't pay any attention to the hard-coded spawn boundaries though. This was the cause of so many headaches in my first game, but I'm keeping the screen size small enough here so that it shouldn't need to adapt to different screen sizes, I think. Next, I need to make the ship AI. I want it to move in just the four cardinal directions toward the coin wherever it spawns, so I created a script resource to put my movement functions in. Then the errors officially started. I haven't used a script resource before, so at first I thought it was because of my lack of knowledge on how to use it correctly. But after a couple hours of testing and searching through documentation, I still couldn't figure out how to get it working. Luckily, we have an amazing Discord community for this channel, link in the description by the way, and Dorizio was nice enough to jump on a call and help me figure it out. I wish I did this sooner because a few minutes into the call was when we figured out that my function was named this, and my code was trying to call a function named this. Dang it. Well, after getting rid of the errors, I was able to run the code and find out that it didn't do what I thought it would. But Dorizio was awesome and talked me through how to get the movement I was looking for from the AI, and by the end of the day, look what we did! This is fully the AI moving and collecting the coin wherever it spawns. And after the bug squashing that happened this first day, it was incredibly satisfying to watch. Day 2 went a lot smoother than day 1. The 2.5 hour Discord call with someone who's used GameMaker before taught me a lot about the engine and how it works. I was also starting to get used to the UI too, which I really liked. Something about everything I need being open in my workspace and double-clicking on an object to quickly scroll to that part of the project is really satisfying. I was feeling a lot more comfortable on day 2, so I was able to make a lot of progress without being slowed down as much by errors. I added a background to the game, learned about the depth attribute, which is kind of like the order that things appear on the screen, and the biggest one, I added the enemy spawns. Something I really noticed on this day was the amount of resources for everything that I wanted to learn how to do. I was able to get most simple things working after just a few minutes of searching online, which is great since I only have 4 more days to finish the game. I used a switch statement to determine the random off-screen location that enemies will spawn, and I wrote it in a way that allows me to reuse it when I eventually bring in different kinds of enemies, which isn't normal for me, writing reusable code, but it probably should be. I linked the spawning of the enemies to an alarm, which is similar to a timer in Godot, so I can easily set the frequency of the spawns by adjusting the alarm. Once I had working enemies, I thought it was time to let the AI ship fight back against them. I made a collision line which seems to act like a raycast, and I added it to the front of the ship. Whenever an enemy hits the line... Wait. Okay, so whenever an enemy hits the line, it fires at the enemy. Eventually, I realized that one line wasn't enough, because the ship would only fire if an enemy was directly in front of it. So I added 2 more lines that both do the same thing. I was also able to find out online how to make the ship flash red when it's hit, and since I haven't mentioned it already, I just want to say that I really like how easy it is to check for collisions with any object. Just add a collision event, and you're done. Well, you still need to add the code for what happens when the collision occurs, but I really like this event system that GameMaker has. The last thing I did on this day was something that I thought was going to be incredibly difficult for someone new to an engine, but it turned out to be pretty easy. Currently, the game is still playing itself, and it doesn't take any player input, so I wanted to make it, well, a game. I want the player to be able to hot swap to take over an enemy, which also gives them a speed boost. I created a sprite for when the mouse is hovering over an enemy, and also for when an enemy is selected. Giving the player the ability to take over an enemy was also really easy with the mouse enter, mouse leave, and left down events. I just create the event, then write the code for what happens. To change between enemies, I used what might be my new favorite function, the with function, which allows you to cycle through all the instances of a particular object. I use this to make sure that all enemies are deselected before selecting a new one. With that, I felt like I did a lot on this day, and I'm tired. Good night. All right, I'm feeling refreshed. My first order of business on day 3 was to add a health bar to the ship. It already did have a health variable, but you could only see it in the form of a debug message in the output window. The cool thing is that GameMaker has a draw health bar function which allows you to create and set the length, width, color, and position of the health bar. I'm starting to think that I picked the perfect engine for this challenge because most of the things that I'm doing, I'm able to get working a lot quicker than I anticipated. Minus the hiccup on the first day, at least. Let's add some more enemies. I started by adding some orange enemies, which are a little faster than their red counterparts, and just like in my first game, they have 2 hit points instead of 1. Next, I added Stretchy, who's a little different. He's slower, but he has 3 hit points, and when you have him selected, you also have full control over his rotation. I did this by having him rotate towards the mouse when you're controlling him. He's pretty fun to move around with. Finally, I added the purple enemies, but they don't really do much yet. I want to make them shoot, but that'll be a tomorrow thing. Good morning! Alright. Something that was bugging me last night was how there's still no audio in the game, and after looking it up, it seems pretty easy to add in, especially since I already have the music and most of the sound effects. I added some sound resources called the Audio Play Sound function, and we have audio! There's going to be a few more sound effects that I'll have to record, but I think I'm going to leave that for day 5, which will be a polishing day. Let's give the purple enemies their lasers. This wasn't too different from the lasers that the ship is able to fire, but these ones are able to travel diagonally. After a few really mesmerizing bugs, I was able to get it working. I also decided to add an arrow that follows the mouse to show the direction that you're aiming as well. Next, I wanted to give the ship an upgrade once it collects enough coins as a callback to the first game. These upgraded lasers do double damage, but it evens out because I also made it so that if you're controlling an enemy when it hits the ship, you do double damage as well. Much like the first game, this is a race to try and beat the game as fast as possible, so I added a little timer at the bottom of the screen, and after that, it was time for bed again. Okay, what better way to close the game loop than on the final day? This was easy enough. I added another room to the game which would act as a You Win screen. Here your final time is displayed, along with a button you can click to restart and try and beat your time. I also made a couple sound effects so certain actions didn't feel so empty. And after a little bit of polishing, we officially have a game. Now, is it the greatest game ever? No, but that's not the point. I learned so much over the last 5 days, and I now understand why game jams are so helpful. This was essentially a little game jam, just with an engine that I've never used before. And what were the results that came out of this? I made a little game in far less time than I thought I was capable. I also learned about a new engine and the basics of how it works. Finally, I learned the importance of checking names of my functions before committing 2 hours of troubleshooting. What about GameMaker though? How was my first experience with it? Honestly, I loved it. It's great to see how other engines do things differently, and I think it's really helpful to know what tools are out there at your disposal. My game might be pretty simple, but from using the tools that GameMaker provides, I know that amazing games are possible with this engine. And there are already a lot out there. I also really like their UI, and especially GameMaker's approach to getting newbies like me up on their feet with the template projects. The event system was a little confusing to me at first, but when I started to use it more, it became one of my favorite things. Overall, if you're looking to learn different tools, I would recommend giving GameMaker a try. They're sponsoring this video, but that's my honest opinion. If you want to try it out, it's free for non-commercial use on all non-console platforms. It has a one-time perpetual license, and it has a really active community from my experience. Again, I want to thank GameMaker for sponsoring this video, and remember to use the link in the description to start building games with it today. I'll also have a link to my Discord if you're looking for a game dev community with awesome people. And finally, I'll have a link to the little game I made in the description as well. Keep learning, and I'll see you in the next video.